And Lorraine, your next question.
So we're back to question one. The prevalence of family violence in the Northwest Territories is staggering. While women and men are both perpetrators and victims, the violence against women and girls is far more severe and more lethal. If elected, what initiatives do you think are important to address family violence?
That question is going now to Great Slave. And as you see, there's three questions from each organization. So that's why I wanted you paying attention. So Great Slave, and we're starting with Chris Clarke on that question.
I just think that luckily I come from a matriarchal family where I've had the opportunity to live with my grandmother, grandfather Doris, and Danny McQueen, and my great-grandmother, Mary Louise King, and as well as my mother, Vivian McQueen, and I think that that's really instilled a lot of values for me towards women and equity for women. I think that the government needs to start early with education for respect of women at a young age and ensure that it is discouraged throughout the school years. And I would like to be a proponent for the integration of childcare prior to traditional classroom schooling with elders for our community. And I think that this would help to bridge a gap between that intergenerational gap and the intersexual act of men or boys and girls, learning respect from a young age with elders. So, in the terms of the Northern traditions, I think that that's helped a lot in the past, and I think that can continue into the future. Thank you.
Thanks, Chris, and next to Glen.
Thank you, and thank you for the question. Unfortunately, I believe the statistics that were quoted actually don't reflect the reality here in the Northwest Territories, and part of the problem is that people aren't talking about it, people aren't raising the issues, and when they do witness family violence, they're not talking about it. I believe that together with organizations like the Coalition Against Family Violence, as well as with the Status of Women, we have an opportunity to work together to start breaking down that stigma. We know that we have, in partnership with these incredible organizations, put forward a number of programs like What Will It Take? What Will It Take is an important training program that I would actually encourage everybody in this room to take, and encourage everybody you know to take What Will It Take? If re-elected, I commit to continuing to promote What Will It Take in order to start having the dialogue and encourage people to talk about the issues that are out there. And I would like to see it delivered in schools, I would like to see it delivered in college campuses, and I'd like to see it delivered in every community, every region in the Northwest Territories. Let's break the stigma, let's start talking about this and start solving the problem.
Thanks, Glen.
Okay, just to repeat the question I asked earlier. Women often face barriers to accessing mental health and addiction services due to a variety of factors, such as lack of safe and stable housing, limited child care options, and a scarcity of northern treatment options. What would you do to address these barriers in order to improve women's access to treatment?
Thanks, Jerry, and this is going to Great Slave, starting with Glen Abernethy.
Thank you. Thank you very much for the question. One of the things that we obviously have to do here in the Northwest Territories is work with childcare and ensure that there's affordable childcare available to our residents in the Northwest Territories, so that if they do have to go to treatment and it's outpatient based or inpatient based, they have an ability to ensure their children are cared for and they have the time to actually go to the treatment. We also need to continue to explore and build upon a number of the programs that we already have available for addiction services in the Northwest Territories. We do have treatment facilities in the south, and we do have outpatient services in the Northwest Territories. We've got to continue to expand many of those outpatient services, like the mobile treatment options that can go from region to community to provide services. This needs to be available at different times for different people, so we need to be able to run programs for women, and then we need to be able to run programs for men, so that we don't have vulnerable populations receiving treatment at the same time. So there's a number of things that we need to do around expanding our outpatient and regional services.
Thank you, Glen. And to you, Chris.
Unlike my opponent here, I agree that we really do need to have an addiction center in the north, and I'm really surprised why it hasn't worked yet. You know, we've made a lot of things work up here, but that's one thing that the government hasn't seemed to be able to do. And I really want to push forward with that in the next assembly. I think that it's crucial for women to have access to these things, and in fact that they're not going to oftentimes leave their children if they're unable to or have to go south, which is what we have to do now. I have a friend, for instance, that She was waiting months to go to an addiction center where they allow children at. And I think that if we have an addiction center here, we can gear it towards women of our culture and our society, and we can gear it towards allowing them to have children with them and or, you know, being closer to the community and their families, so that we go back to that, again, that traditional support system of family and children and whatnot. Thank you.
Thank you, Chris. We will move on next to Alternatives North, and Christina Pop is going to ask the question. So Christina, I invite you to ask your first question.
So the first question, poverty is a major cost to society wherever it exists in terms of healthcare and other services provided by government. The NWT has one of the largest gaps between high and lowest income of any Canadian jurisdiction. Poverty is a gender issue. It disproportionately impacts women. So the question is, if elected, what would you do to reduce poverty, socioeconomic inequality, and food insecurity in Yellowknife and the NWT? Thank you.
Thank you, Christina. And that's this time it goes to Great Slave, starting with Chris Clarke.
So I need you to repeat that much more slowly and one more time.
Okay. If elected, what will you do to reduce poverty, socioeconomic inequality, and food insecurity in the NWT?
For women or in general?
Take it as you like.
Okay, so I guess then we can start here with our stance on the poverty issue and looking at the lowest or the most affected by poverty, which are the homeless people in town here. And that number is only growing. And that number is also, you know, directly related to violence against women in terms of those homeless women. You see it on the streets all the time, fights and whatnot. So I really think that we need to have a place for them where they can actually have a home. And what my idea for that was that we'll have a center where they can all have a room that they will live in, and there could also be, you know, a wet facility, so we're not going to stop them from drinking or anything else. But there'll also be dry facilities and counseling within the center, AA programs and whatnot, so that we can really help them get out of that first initial poverty level. And I guess that brings me to my end.
Chris.
Thanks.
And to you, Glen.
Thank you. Thank you very much. We need to continue to build upon the good work that was started by the Anti-Poverty Coalition that actually translated into the anti-poverty framework that exists here in the Northwest Territories. There's five pillars under that strategy that need action. The GNWT currently invests $500,000 that is available to applications that come in under those strategies. I'd like to explore expanding that funds to at least $1 million moving forward. We've seen great results on the $500,000, but it would be great to see more. We also need an agricultural strategy here in the Northwest Territories to help us with food security. That's going to support everybody, including women. With respect to homelessness, this is a major issue here in the Northwest Territories that does need to be addressed. And I think there's a number of great groups out there starting the work, but we've got to stop working in silos and we've got to start working together. Also within the GNWT, we need to actually move forward with the gender-based analysis and make it available to all program designers and deliverers here in the Northwest Territories to address all the inequity issues that we're facing.
Thank you, Glen. All right, Caleb, your next question.
When families and individuals begin to experience a crisis, other aspects of life often begin to deteriorate. Any one of the following can lead to the others: unemployment, financial debt, conflict with the law, physical illness or onset of disability, addictions, family breakdown, family violence. Yet the various social supports that exist to assist with any one of these are in different government departments or subdepartments. Do you see this as a problem facing the government? If not, why not? If yes, what kind of steps will you take to solve it?
Thank you, and this goes to Great Slave, starting with Glen Abernethy.
Thank you, and thank you for the question. If one individual had one problem at one time, most of the programs and services that are available in the GNWT would be able to address that. Unfortunately, the reality is there are multiple problems or multiple challenges that individuals are facing. So they do have to utilize services in different departments, which can be incredibly frustrating. During the last assembly, one of our colleagues, Mr. Bromley, brought to the attention of the government a lot of situations where these departments running programs are actually running across purposes, or actually causing one program in one department is making it impossible to access another program in another department. The cabinet of the day put together a social envelope committee of cabinet, which was tasked with trying to address a number of these problems. At the time, we were able to identify that some of the problems were purely communication. Some of them were actually problems within the system, and others were much larger problems where the programs didn't work. We need to continue to do this analysis. We need to continue to address these problems. We need to continue to streamline to make sure that you accessing the programs can get the services you
need. Thank you, Glen. And Chris?
Thank you for the question. Yeah, you know, crisis happens in families all the time, but I think in the North it happens a lot more than elsewhere. And I think a lot of that has to do with isolation and social problems from an early age. I think one thing that occurs when there's a crisis in the family is our broken system of child care and child welfare. You know, right now we look at the child first, which is great, but I think that causes, that's the root of a lot more problems that that come into the future. So I have had a foster child that lived in our family that my mom took care of, and he ended up committing suicide just because of just the outstanding things that happened to him in his life. And I think that had we have a family first kind of system of child welfare where we try to help the family as opposed to just removing the child, then we will be able to make more stable families in the future, not just remove children into foster care that really doesn't work. Thank you, Chris.
Great slate late. So Lorna Skinner, I hope you don't mind us moving your question to a different writing. Thank you. The last legislative assembly spent $49 million to relieve the cost of power in the NWT. If elected, will you implement an energy plan, and what will that look like? Let's start with Chris.
So I guess as my first degree is in a bachelor's of science in environmental science, and so I have a lot of experience in terms of, you know, renewable energies and whatnot, as well as having a master's in architecture. I'm a LEED accredited professional, which is leadership in energy and environmental design. So I have a lot of experience with understanding that the power grid that we have is not sustainable because we need multiple sources of power so that when things go down, water levels lower, or our oil level or oil prices increase, then we have alternatives to connect to. We need to ensure that all the connections throughout the North are increased as well, so that when one community goes out of power, then others do too. I think we can also have power-based systems on biomass and mass heating through communities, and you know, that's a long time traditional thing of gathering wood and heating our communities with.
Thank you, Chris. And finally to Glen.
Absolutely, we actually need to take action immediately to address these issues. The government of the Northwest Territories owns a significant amount of buildings. There's no reason we can't start putting solar panels on top of these buildings, buildings like jails, schools, other facilities around the Northwest Territories. We also need to move immediately in places like Inuvik with wind generation, because we already know that the wind is there that we need. We also need to enhance our capital asset retrofit here within the government of the Northwest Territories to improve efficiencies within the government. We need to make bursaries and rebates available to our public so that they can purchase and put in the technology themselves and help contribute to the production of power. Together, working with organizations like Alternatives North, like working with Ecology North, working with other organizations, we should be able to expand these rebates, make it affordable and available to all. We also need to explore the possibility of having other providers come to the Northwest Territories with solar solutions, wind solutions to produce power that we can purchase at a reasonable rate. We need to explore all these options. We need to act now. We need to have this solution in place immediately.
Thank you. And next to Great Slave and Chris Clarke.
Again, I'd just like to thank everybody for attending tonight, and this has been, as Dave said, the best turnout of any of the forums tonight, and I also, this last couple weeks, sorry, but I also like to commend whoever made this stew, because it is absolutely delicious. So thank you for that. I'm also thankful that, you know, I'm an educated Dunny man, and I come from a long line of strong Dunny women, and I look forward to working with women's groups going forward. And as an architect, I've worked on many projects, and oftentimes in when I was working and interning in Toronto, up to $500 million. So I understand how to deal with complex issues, that arise with the government. And I've also have about 8 years of cumulative experience with government regulations and whatnot in the Northwest Territories. So I really look forward to working directly with my constituents and other Northerners as the next MLA from Yellowknife Great Slave Lake. Thanks.
Thank you, Chris. And we'll close off Great Slave with Glen Abernethy.
Thank you. Thank you very much. And we only have a minute, so I'll ask that that you take a look at my webpage, glenabernethy.com, where I've actually posted answers to all the questions that have been submitted to me over the last 3 weeks. In selecting your MLA, you need to think, and this is for everybody up here, not just about the things that we're saying, because much of what you heard this evening is exactly the same from all the candidates, but you need to think about who's going to do the work and how are they going to do it. Who's going to work with stakeholders? Who's going to listen to stakeholders? Who's going to engage with stakeholders? I don't pretend to know everything, but what I do is I work with stakeholders. I get out and meet with individuals from the status of women, from different organizations who help educate me and help me be informed as I move forward. I'm not about the status quo. I'm about change, and I've moved this government in many ways. Health transformation, building stronger families, the anti-poverty work is work that I've done in partnership with organizations, and I commit to continue working with organizations and partners to bring real change to the Northwest Territories.
Thank you, Glen. And so can we all please, ladies and gentlemen, we are so blessed to have so many fabulous candidates putting their name out there and doing the hard work to try and get into a job where they're going to begin to do the hard work. So a big round of applause for our candidates. To Lorraine and Sammy and Anamika from the Status of Women for organizing this. And let's give a super big hand to the ladies from the kitchen. Northern Chicks. Thank you. And also to Alternatives North, Christina, to YWCA, Kayla, Jerry from the Yellowknife Women's Society. Did I get you all? And Alyssa from the Native Women's Association, thank you all so much for the work your organizations did in putting questions together. We really appreciate your efforts. So that wraps up our evening. Please make sure and tell your friends who weren't here that they need to get out and vote too.